Hello, and welcome to Dogs with Torches, Episode 8. If you could sit down and speak to any theologian, be it ancient, modern, or contemporary, of whom would you choose? As you all know, I am a big fan of St. Thomas Aquinas and his philosophy. And I wanted to do a tribute podcast episode for his feast day. So for this podcast episode, we will be looking at the history and legacy in the school of Thomism, as a philosophical and theological school from the earliest defenders of the great saint's work to the neo-Thomists of the 20th century. Thank you all so much for listening, and enjoy the podcast episode. You've got to find the bunk, you must have faith and believe. You've got to give of yourself, for you're worthy to receive. Drink all the water you can hold, wash your face to your feet. Believe the bottle full for others, thank you kindly, desert me. This podcast episode will rely heavily on Romanus Cesario's book by the same name, and I'll put a link for it in the description. So before we discuss the history of the school, we should give a brief introduction to Thomas Aquinas' life, and what exactly is Thomism. Thomas Aquinas was a 13th century Italian theologian. Born into a wealthy family, he left a promising career as a Benedictine abbot behind to join the Dominicans, who had recently begun to grow in numbers at this time. He was a prolific writer who wrote biblical commentaries, disputed questions, and philosophical commentaries on Aristotle. His greatest work is the Summa Theologica, a theology text he wrote to aid beginning students and seminarians in the university, as well as the Summa Contra Gentiles, a handbook made for preachers when disputing with non-Christians. He was a friend with the great Franciscan theologian Bonaventure, and helped to write numerous hymns and songs for the church, the most famous ones being Pange Lingua and Adorote Devote. His greatest achievement is his treatise on the Eucharist and transubstantiation, and shortly after writing on the sacrament, he ceased to continue writing after experiencing a mystical encounter. So now that we understand a bit about the theologian, we have to understand what is and what constitutes his theology. Just what exactly is Thomism? In the broad sense, it is a theological school that draws its inspiration and principles from the thought of St. Thomas Aquinas, and a Thomist is one who studies the theology of St. Thomas. In a stricter sense, Thomism is a theological and philosophical movement that begins in the 13th century and embodies a systematic attempt to understand and develop the basic principles and conclusions of St. Thomas Aquinas. It is under this definition of Thomism that we will rely upon, and focus not so much on the more eclectic versions of Thomism throughout history. Traditionally, Thomism has been divided into either three or four periods of history. The 13th to 15th centuries are characterized as a period of defense of Aquinas' theology against the older schools of thought. The mid-15th to 16th century is characterized as a period of a tradition of writing commentaries on Aquinas' writings, and most especially on the Summa Theologica. And finally, from the time of the Council of Trent to the mid-18th century, is characterized as a period of disputationes, or disputed questions, which argued over particular doctrines espoused by Thomas Aquinas. In addition to this threefold division, some historians add a fourth division as well, that of neo-Thomism in the early 19th to 20th centuries, a school that revitalized Thomism in the modern era. Now, one more point to make before discussing the centuries of Thomism itself. We should give a brief account of the intellectual stagnation and decline in interest in certain periods of time. The three instances of significant decline in interest in Aquinas' theology are in the 14th century, with the coming of the Black Death over Europe, the rise of Protestantism in the 16th century, and the French Revolution in the 18th century. Towards the end of the 14th century, Thomism underwent a period of stagnation and decline. The two reasons for this are the rise of the Franciscan schools of Scotism and William of Ockham, and the Black Death. As a result of the catastrophic death toll that affected Europe, the number of teachers at the universities were substantially reduced, and the ones that survived to teach were not always the most competent at teaching. With the rise of Protestantism in the 16th century, countries that had been powerhouses for Thomism, like in Germany with the Rhineland mystics, had shifted in focus in the theology from a Catholic to a Protestant persuasion. At the University of Oxford, with the separation of the English bishops from Rome, the Dominicans who had resided there for centuries were evicted from the university. Finally, with the French Revolution, many religious convents and monasteries were savagely evicted from France, and the University of Paris, which had for the longest time been a stronghold for Catholic theology, was eventually converted into a secular university. So now that we've covered Thomism and Thomas Aquinas' life, and have given a brief overview of the divisions of history, we will now turn to the late 13th century when Thomas Aquinas was still alive. With the rediscovery of Aristotelian texts in the West, many traditionally minded theologians took a negative view of Aristotle's philosophy. In 1270, while Aquinas was still alive, the Bishop of Paris, Stephen Tempier, prohibited certain Aristotelian theses from being used in philosophical discourse, and in 1277, after Aquinas' death, Tempier had issued a stronger condemnation of Aristotle within the university, with 219 theses being prohibited. Some of these theses were explicitly taught by St. Thomas, and many at the university began to take a negative opinion of his philosophical system. Some Thomistic doctrines condemned were Aquinas' theories of the soul and his overall agnostic attitude in being able to demonstrate the finitude of the universe versus its eternity, as well as denying the principle of universal hylomorphism. With these condemnations and overall distrust of Aquinas' philosophy, some of his students and teachers came to his defense. His great teacher, Albert of Cologne, or Albert the Great, came back to Paris to defend his student, and the Dominican theologian Giles of Lessines came to Aquinas' defense as well. Giles particularly defended Aquinas' theory of the soul against the older Augustinian model, and wrote De Unitate Formae in defense of his doctrine. After a period of time, however, Aquinas was designated as no longer a threat to the university, and his work was permitted to be circulated, even among the Franciscans, who had initially opposed the innovations. Nevertheless, the Franciscan theologian William de la Mare ensured that the Summa Theologiae in circularity had certain corrections written in them, and some theologians like John Peckham vigorously continued to oppose Thomism within their lifetimes. Now, interest in Thomism grew outside of Paris as the Dominican professors gradually began to spread into England, Germany, and Italy. One of the earliest English Dominicans, Thomas of Sutton, was one of the first to address John Duns Scotus's arguments against analogy. In addition to this, William of Macclesfield, an Oxford lecturer, defended Aquinas' more controversial theses without suffering the repercussions others did while at Paris. Towards the end of the 13th to mid-14th century, interest in Thomism in England had diminished with the school of nominalism and William of Ockham becoming more popular at that time. At France, in addition to Giles of Lessines' defense of the soul, Bernard of Trillia also mounted an enthusiastic support for Aquinas' philosophy. Jean Guidort defended the theory of the soul as well as the metaphysical distinction between a thing's essence and its existence. Finally, with Italy and Germany towards the end of the 13th century, we find an enthusiastic love for Aquinas as well. One Italian Dominican, Bartholomew of Lucca, helped complete Aquinas' unfinished work, De Regimine Principum, which had been left incomplete, and many short practical treatises based on Thomism were made popular at around this time. Finally, in Germany, many of the great Rhineland theologians utilized Thomism and the theology of Albert the Great and stressed the Neoplatonic aspects of the respective philosophies. The Rhineland mystics such as Meister Eckhart, Henry Suso, and John Tauler had tremendous love for Thomistic metaphysics and theology. Thomism started off in the 14th century with a bang, and interest in Aquinas increased especially at the University of Paris. Notable Thomists at this time were Armand de Belvezer, Peter Paludanus, and William Peter Godinus, who besides aiding in the Franciscan dispute during his time, had helped convince Pope John XXII to canonize St. Thomas Aquinas. On July 18, 1323, Thomas Aquinas was canonized as saint, and Stephen Barrett, the Bishop of Paris, reversed the condemnations of 1277 that had been implemented by his predecessor, Stephen Tempier. Towards the end of the 14th century, due to the controversies over the Western Schism, the Black Death, and the rise of the Franciscan schools of Scotus and Ockham, Thomism had declined in interest among European universities. But at the same time, Thomism began to spread to other parts outside of Western Europe. In Byzantium, the theologian Gregory Akindinos translated the Summa Contra Gentiles into Greek, and the study of Aquinas spread into Bohemia, Poland, and Scandinavia. Towards the end of the 14th century, Blessed Raymond of Capua, the confessor of St. Catherine of Siena, helped carry interest in Thomism in spite of its obstacles. And while interest in Thomism in the 14th century was stagnated, it nevertheless procured a plethora of manuscripts dedicated to the interest in Thomistic metaphysics. Finally, the great controversy between the Franciscan schools and the Thomistic schools was heightened over the debate concerning the Immaculate Conception of Mary. The doctrine of the Immaculate Conception, which states that Mary was conceived without original sin, was a doctrine enthusiastically supported by the Franciscans and argued against by the Dominicans. St. Thomas was hesitant about the doctrine of the Immaculate Conception, as to him it seemed to make the death of Jesus Christ altogether superfluous. Together with St. Bonaventure and Bernard of Clairvaux, he argued against the doctrine in his writings and in the Summa. The Franciscans, by contrast, following Duns Scotus, argued that Mary's conception was a result of the fruits of her son's death, and that she was prevented from contracting original sin inherited to all of Adam's descendants. In the mid-14th century to the early 15th century, one particular Thomas stands out among others as one who encouraged the study of Aquinas in the face of the schools of Scotus and Ockham. Designated as the Prince of Thomists, Jean Capriolus stands as a bridge between the older tradition of defending and the new tradition of commenting on the thought of Aquinas. He argued against the prevailing Scotistic and nominalist schools of his day and wrote an influential compendium of Thomistic theology titled Book of Arguments in Defense of the Theology of St. Thomas Aquinas, which later theologians would use for centuries. But what makes Jean Capriolus unique is his precedent for writing lengthy commentaries on Aquinas' work. While the earlier medieval schools commented on the sentences of Peter Lombard, Jean Capriolus began a tradition of commenting on the Summa Theologica, and later theologians would follow suit in this tradition. Other influential Thomists at this time were Peter of Bergamo, who had compiled one of the first indexes of Aquinas' writings, which would not be supplanted again until the 20th century, when Robert Busa, of the Society of Jesus, compiled the Index Thomisticus. Even non-academic philosophers of this time utilized Thomism, and some humanists, such as Pietro Pomponazzi, studied Aquinas as a commentator on Aristotle. Whereas Thomism had ended in the 15th century strong, Aquinas' theology entered the 16th century in the midst of theological turmoil at the advent of the Protestant Reformation. Several humanist scholars began to express extreme prejudice and distrust of scholasticism. Desiderius Erasmus, at this time, in his Praise of Folly, chided scholastic metaphysicians for discussing the subtlest of subtleties, and lamented that the esteemed Aquinas never learned Greek or Hebrew. The more marginal strand of humanism that began to distrust theological discourse was very much in the vogue at this point in time, and was intensified with the Protestant Reformation and the grievances of Martin Luther. Catholic countries were the only safe haven for Thomistic philosophy during this period, and Thomism took firm root in the territories governed especially by the Habsburg princes. During this theological upheaval, one influential interlocutor stood out among the rest of the Catholic theologians. Thomas de Villocajetan was an influential theologian and cardinal, who, like Capriolus, had written an extensive commentary on the Summa Theologica. His commentary proved to be so influential that in the 19th century, Leo XIII would publish his work along with the critical additions to Aquinas' Summa. Now, Cajetan drew heavily upon the thought of Capriolus and developed a complex understanding of semantic analogy in response to the Scotistic schools of his day. He was the ambassador to the Pope in Germany and personally spoke with Martin Luther himself on points of contention in his theology. With the precedent set forth by Capriolus nearly a century earlier, Catholic theologians began to write lengthy commentaries on the Summa Theologica in response to Martin Luther and John Calvin's theologies, and many relied upon Capriolus's Book of Arguments as well. Finally, at the Council of Trent, many Thomists were influential in shaping the direction of the Council. The doctrines regarding justification and transubstantiation drew heavily from the thought of St. Thomas Aquinas, and Pope Pius V decreed Thomas Aquinas to be a doctor of the Universal Church. Towards the end of the 16th century and the early 17th century, Thomism resumed its place as a school among other schools that took up complex theological topics and disputed questions. Dominicans found themselves arguing against the Jesuit school on points of doctrine regarding grace and predestination. This debate was known as the Congregatio de Auxiliis controversy. Without going too much into the controversy itself, it was a debate that tried to reconcile God's providence and the primacy of grace with the freedom of the human person. The Spanish Dominican theologian Domingo Báñez took a more conservative and Thomistic approach to the problem and argued for what he called physical premotion. In this teaching, God moves the will to achieve its proper end without frustrating the freedom of the human person and permitting that person to mysteriously fall away from the grace, if the human person so chooses. In contrast to Báñez, the Jesuit Luis de Molina argued for what he called scientia media, or middle knowledge of God. In this knowledge, God knows all the goods humans would have accomplished had he not given them grace, and then dispenses grace depending on how the person would have acted. This, according to Molina, saves human freedom while securing the importance of divine providence and grace. The controversy and argumentation over this matter ended with a stalemate, with both positions being permitted to teach their theological point of view in spite of the tension. Much more can be said on this controversy, and I'll put a link in the description to a podcast episode related to this topic. Another influential Thomist at this time was John of St. Thomas. This 17th century theologian and professor was a near contemporary of René Descartes, but was on the opposite end of the spectrum philosophically. He wrote a 9-volume commentary on Aquinas' writings called the Cursus Philosophicus Thomisticus. In addition to this, John of St. Thomas wrote a short theological treatise called The Gifts of the Holy Spirit, an essay on the interior life of the human person. This treatise is so popular that it has even been translated into modern languages in contemporary times. I'll put a link in the description for those who'd like to read it. John's theological writings and commentary on Aristotle proved to be so influential for later Spanish theologians, and most especially for the discalced Carmelite theologians of Salamanca. The 17th century produced a plethora of commentaries on the Summa from nearly every nationality, with some even being written in the New World. Even those who are from a more Protestant persuasion and opposed to Catholicism utilized Aquinas in different ways, most prominently King James I of England. Unfortunately, in the 18th century, Thomism would suffer a decline in interest in the midst of the Scientific Revolution and the advent of the French Revolution. In the early 18th century, the commentary tradition continued with the controversialist Noel Alexander writing on the Summa. Charles René Billouard's 19-volume commentary on the Summa Theologica was also an impressive achievement at this time as well. Finally, Daniele Concina's writings on moral theology, and most especially his commentary on the Prima Secunda of St. Thomas, helped reintroduce the importance of teleology in ethics and emphasize the importance of love and charity in the spiritual life. From about 1789 to 1850, Thomism suffered a massive decline in interest, most especially in France due to the Revolution, but also in Belgium, Germany, and even Italy. Secular philosophies were by far more popular, and because of this, studies of Thomism were driven to become a more marginal strand of thought than it had previously been. Nevertheless, in certain places, Thomism remained a particular area of interest as a philosophy. In Venice, especially from about 1745 to 1788, Thomistic literature was widely published, and in Tsarist Russia in the 1730s, Aquinas' writings received attention and interest as well. While the French Revolution placed Thomism to the margins of intellectual thought, it did not succeed in destroying it. Indeed, the Kennedy Catalog lists over 300 Thomists in the early 19th century. Most especially in northern Italy, the seminary Collegio Alberoni remained committed to the study of Thomistic thought. In an effort to return to the thought of pre-modernity, one especially influential Jesuit, Serafino Sordi, campaigned for seminaries to return to scholasticism as a model for intellectual discourse and argued that Thomism could be a school that could combat the secular philosophies of Kantianism and Hegelianism, which were prominent at the time. Sordi wrote and produced manuals of scholasticism for seminaries, which at the time were studying Cartesian philosophy, and his manuals proved to be so effectual that they were even used well into the 20th century. Now, manualism, which was a system of education that relied on theological handbooks and textbooks in place of using primary texts, is a tradition that can be traced back all the way to the 17th century, with the manuals written by Antoine Goudon, the Order of Preachers. Many theologians such as Sordi, Carlo Maria Corci, and Giovanni Maria Cornoldi campaigned at this time for a return to the pre-modern thought of Aquinas in seminaries and colleges. While this initial attempt failed, it was enough to influence the thought of young Gioacchino Pecci, who would later grow up to become Pope Leo XIII. After being elected Pope, Leo XIII promulgated his encyclical Eterni Patris, which emphasized a return to the thought of the Christian philosophers, and most especially that of St. Thomas. The famed Eterni Patris proved to be successful in supplanting the Cartesian manuals in seminaries and bolstered a return to the study of Thomism. Italian theologian Gaetano Sanseverino created the first academy dedicated to the study of Thomism in Italy, and in the First Vatican Council, the dogmatic constitution Dei Filius argued for the mutual cooperation of faith and reason and their compatibility with each other after the manner expressed by St. Thomas. The 20th century produced a number of influential and important Thomistic commentators and theologians, as well as a diverse range of interpretation. To this, we'll limit our attention to two of the more prominent schools of thought, and three of the more prominent Thomistic philosophers to come out of this period. In an effort to answer the philosophical critiques of modernity, several Catholic theologians, particularly Karl Rahner and Bernard Lonergan, attempted to synthesize the writings and thought of Immanuel Kant with Thomas Aquinas. Rahner especially attempted to synthesize Kantian epistemology with the arguments for the existence of God. Another school to come about was the so-called River Forest Thomism in River Forest, Illinois. This school, while not denying the primacy of existence and metaphysics in Aquinas, argued for a strong adherence to Aristotelian philosophy as a model to strive for in the philosophy of science. As such, they tend to be the more scientifically oriented school of Thomism in contemporary studies. Finally, before we wrap up this podcast episode, it would be a good idea to pay tribute to three of the most famous and illustrious Thomistic commentators in the neo-scholastic project of the 20th century, that being Jacques Maritain, Étienne Gilson, and Reginald Garrieu-Lagrange. Jacques Maritain was a philosopher who was introduced to the thought of Thomas Aquinas after becoming disenchanted with a reductive scientism of his day. His work touched upon epistemology, metaphysics, and ethical and political theory. He is known for his work especially on the study and highlight of the transcendentals of Aquinas' metaphysics, his work The Degrees of Knowledge, which argued for a direct realist approach towards epistemology, and his writings synthesizing Christian philosophy with democracy. His theories of political philosophy brought him into close conflict with his friend Father Reginald Garrieu-Lagrange, who was an ardent monarchist. In addition to his writings on Aquinas, he helped draft the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and was a personal confidant to Pope Paul VI. Étienne Gilson was a French medieval historian who specialized in the thought of the scholastic philosophy. His greatest achievements were his writings in the field of epistemology and metaphysics, and setting up the Pontifical Institute of Medieval Studies in Toronto. In the field of the epistemology, He argued against attempting to synthesize early modern epistemology with that of Aquinas, as some neo-scholastics had done, and wrote several short pamphlets on this very subject, such as Methodical Realism and Thomist Realism and the Critique of Knowledge. Both of these are wonderful to read and have been translated from French into English. I'll also link both of these in the description below for those who are interested. And in terms of metaphysics, Gilson had argued for the primacy of being in Aquinas' metaphysics as a model for interpreting the five ways, and opposed a reading put forward by Cajetan of Aquinas' metaphysics. His reading of Aquinas proved to be so influential that a school came about as a result of it, dubbed the School of Existential Thomism, which continues to this day. His most famous writings on Aquinas' metaphysics is his influential Being in Some Philosophers, as well as The Christian Philosophy of St. Thomas Aquinas. For a good introduction to the thought of these thinkers, I'd recommend Father Thomas Joseph White's Wisdom in the Face of Modernity. Finally, no summary of neo-scholasticism can be complete without reference to the greatest of the Thomistic theologians, Father Reginald Garrigou-Lagrange. Dubbed the sacred monster of Thomism, Father Garrigou-Lagrange was a scholastic manualist who encouraged the further study of Thomism in the 20th century. He is best known for fighting and opposing the heresies of modernism within the Church, and argued for a strict observance to Aquinas' theology in his writings. He taught and assisted many famous theologians at the Angelicum, the most well-known being the then Karol Wojtyla, who would later go on to become Pope John Paul II. His greatest work, The Three Ages of the Interior Life, synthesized the writings of John of the Cross with the writings of Thomas Aquinas. An avid admirer of John of the Cross, it is believed that he assisted in Pope Pius XI declaring him a doctor of the Universal Church. In addition to this, he is known for his extended commentaries on Aquinas' Summa Theologica, his concise summary of Thomism called Reality, a synthesis of Thomistic thought, and his writings defending the arguments for the existence of God, in his two-volumed God, His Existence and His Nature, A Thomistic Solution. Finally, he is known for defending the thought of Domingo Báñez and his interpretation of Aquinas' understanding of grace. For a good biography of his life and legacy, I recommend Sacred Monster of Thomism, Life and Legacy, Reginald Garrigou-Lagrange. While I had intended this podcast episode to be a good summary of Thomism's history, for the sake of time, I had to skip over a comprehensive treatment of the condemnations of 1277, the Jesuit Thomists, the De Auxiliis controversy, and the phenomenological school of Thomism that developed in the 20th century. While this episode is in no way exhaustive of the history of Thomistic philosophy, I hope it serves as a good introduction to further interest in this fascinating area of study. Thank you all so much for listening to this podcast episode of Dogs with Torches. Be sure to like, subscribe, and share with your friends, because, as the angelic doctor says... Just as it is better to illuminate than merely to shine, so too is it better to pass on what one has contemplated than merely to contemplate. Thank you all so much for listening, and God bless.
Well, I found that jar, and I tell you, nothing was ever prettier to my eye. And I was tempted strong to drink it, because that pump looked mighty dry. But the note went on, have faith, my friend, there's water down below. You've got to give until you get, I'm the one who ought to know. So I poured in the jar and I started pumping, and I heard a beautiful sound of water bubbling and splashing out of that hole in the ground. I took off my shoes and I drunk my fill of that cool, refreshing treat. I thank the Lord, I thank the pump, and I thank old Desert Pete.
You've got to find the pump, you must have faith and believe. You've got to give of yourself, for you're worthy to receive.